Councillor Steve Radford, leader of the Liverpool Party Group, Tuberville and Stonycourt, and deputising for Councillor Labour this evening.
Councillor Joann, Liberal Party, Tuberville and Stonycourt.
Frank Martin, Chair of the Foundation of Liverpool House of Commons.
David Dickinson, Director of DK Architects.
Samantha Campbell, Head of Planning. Thank you.
council we've let our first two properties in Victor Ward, which is great. There was, you know, more than 50 people interested in each property, so it's a start. It's only three, but it is a start in terms of our ambitions of council housing. Extending landlord licence in the application will be going in on the 2nd of August, so the consultation period for landlord licensing is now done. As being, it was accepted a cabinet last Friday, and the way that the officers put in was absolutely immense. The way the detail in terms of sort of our case for landlord licensing in the city was fantastic. So hopefully that will go our way. Indications are that, you know, it will, so that's all good. When I gave out the priorities last time, we were looking at sort of what we can do around meeting the housing needs in the city. And I think it's really important for people to understand this back motion in my report. I think people think, oh, you know, the bedroom tax and wages are all put in. The biggest issue that we've got in the city is around the supply. And the supply and the demand on the bedroom tax has had a massive, massive impact. The whole welfare reform has had a massive impact on the actual numbers because people are obviously affected by the bedroom taxes, the under-occupancy, there's the benefit cap and the local house allowance, which is all having a massive impact, which is really making us struggle with the supply of what we've got in the city and the number of one-bedroom properties and the demand for them, where we can't actually meet the demand. So a motion to sort of, we're going to have a housing select committee, a housing council, so that would be interesting. But in terms of that motion, and we get the government to look at it again, because it's just not working. It's not working for cities like ours, when the supply and the demand is actually now way out of kilter because of the effects of the bedroom tax, the welfare reforms, and all of the relating to it. HMOs, I had a very interesting meeting on Wednesday last week in Picton Ward. It's absolutely at crisis level in terms of HMOs in Picton Ward and across the city. The stuff that we're doing around the article for Radford, that is moving along, but it's not moving along at the pace that obviously residents are desperate for. But I think the understanding for residents, it was a very good meeting. We are going to have lots of people around the table to look at it there, because we're putting in one for a number of wards across the city this time, but it's the evidence base, because if we get it wrong, we don't have the evidence base, then, you know, it's no good really. And it's got to be, the evidence has got to be based on harm and economic harm, not just on. I went to that residence meeting and it was absolutely heart-wrenching for some of them residents what they're putting up with at the speed and the rate that them HMOs are going up in Picton. But will the mental health and all the other things and the effects it's having on them stack up? No, it won't. It has to be on economic impact. What I've been told, officers might be able to. Steve's looking at me saying, oh, I think you've got that wrong.
No, it's fine.
Obviously, Steve, you can answer some questions at the end.
Yeah.
When I walked into the one that you got for Green Bank, and I've asked the questions in terms of Green Bank, the article for and how you got it, that was based on the economic impact, and it was things like when all the students went, the shops, and it was, you know, the effects it had on the shops and the local sort of. So, in terms of what I've been informed, and, you know, when I'm wrong, and officers are saying, you know, can support that, we've got to get that evidence base right. So, in terms of particularly the residents from Picton, who have got all sorts of really good sorts of evidence for the misery that they're living in for this. Because we want to put in one, because there's a number of wards across the city, Stonycroft being one of them, Banfield, Central Ward, where there's lots of this stuff happening, we have to get it right. So the consultants are going to be, I think the consultants are appointed, and they're going to start looking at that evidence base between now and the end of the summer. And then we will submit a citywide article for directive and obviously bring back any developments to the committee. Or any wards that are affected more so will be obviously feeding into it because of the evidence base. So that's where we are with HMOs. The housing market, you know, there's lots of stuff that's been going on, and obviously you can see in the reports in terms of the great work that's still continuing in the Welsh streets. There's lots of stuff in there that's going on. Homes for the Parliament,
if that continues on that trajectory of people with no recourse benefits because people from other cities have not the same offer of us, when do we have always room inside? When does it stop if people from Chester and people from Manchester and people, because we've got this unique offer of always room inside, particularly for people with no recourse to benefits? Well, they just keep coming and we really need to look at it. So that is something which I've said, you know, we really need to start looking at that and thinking, you know, do we need to change it? I'm not saying we don't need to offer people with recourse, but we do need another solution to it if it continues the way it is. The number of people who are presenting the housing options continues to increase. And obviously, there's going to be a complete review, and that's something that Sam's going to be involved in on property school, because it's in some ways not fit for purpose in terms of the. Because we have got the supply of properties, it's, you know, so I'm happy to have some questions.
May I ask members if you have questions?
Just a couple of questions, and I appreciate, you know, we've taken the basis of the council's children report. On the extended licensing scheme, I was wondering if you'd like to clarify where we're at to. I understood for a while Serco, who is a landlord of Master Debt, yes, I will stand by that in court, were trying to avoid registration. They were trying to avoid registration. Is it now the case that they are registered? Fine, that's very helpful. Okay. On housing needs, you mentioned about evidence. Totally understand about the need for evidence and the evidence to be evaluated in an economic way. The only reason why I looked slightly strangely in the best sense was when you say mental health. Was one of the issues about high turnover, unstable communities. One of the things that could be used is, I think the Institute of Economic Affairs actually done some calculations of the costs of mental health impact in communities. So we can say, for instance, if I was doing some research for Tudor, I might be inclined to ask the GP practices what they view the costs of that service was in that community. So there might be ways we can articulate the costs of the social implications rather than see it as being a too big of a ask.
I don't think in terms of, I think for instance, maybe I wasn't being clear, it's not the mental health of the people, particularly in the HMOs, it's the effect that HMOs are having on the residents in the community. So in terms of, you know, it was hardly last week about me because they're literally, they are on the edge, that residents who have lived there for many years and say, we can't cope with it. And what you're saying in terms of the social impact and all the other things and cost to services, I completely agree. Or, and I don't know whether any officers can, I've been told, yeah, because I asked that question, didn't I, Abdul, you know, would that be acceptable in terms of, you know, the cost of all the services relating to, you know, these people who are having complete misery because of them. And I've been told it is the economic impact, so I completely take on board, and I know what you're saying in terms of the bigger picture.
But if, for instance, in HMOs in my own ward have been dysfunctional, there is an impact on the amount of cleansing charges we have to pick up with. Is a very clear strap line. If you take a ceteris paribus, if you take a community where there isn't any HMOs, a similar one in the area that has got HMOs, you could actually probably participate the difference on housing costs and health costs. So, and the reason I'm asking that is, whilst I appreciate it is right that we need to underpin with research and advice, I know that there was a discussion about Newshoot Park, which was fairly loosely defined as parts of Fairfield and not parts of Fairfield, where that is up to, because as far as I know as a ward councillor, we've not had any consultation about drilling down that advice or evidence base.
No, the consultants have only just been appointed.
We're going on next week, quite a chance to attend. It should be next week. We're just finalising the document. And if everything goes through, we'll be going on next week to appoint to invite consultants.
Can I say in a positive way, if If your people need some search facilities or base, we can provide a certain of the URC or the Pope Centre without charge to assist if that's any help. Because sometimes actually having a little base is a great way of finding evidence. I'm just trying to get out of the NHS. Sorry if I go on to. If you don't mind. On the housing renewal, I always get nervous when the Labour Party talk about housing renewal, because in the past that has meant how do we force working class people out of their homes into debt with the demolition programme. When you say housing renewal, how do you envisage housing market renewal going forward? Will we be returning to the mass demolitions where we've turned half of edge bed into grazing land for sheep pigs?
I think that all depends on. Really, really lucky in terms of getting our housing and build count. We now can build council housing, which is massive. But in terms of getting money from Homes England, they're not going to just give money to us. They're not going to give the money to the world.
That's not the question I'm asking. When you're saying the housing market renewal, is your intention? So remember when
it's not all going to be new build though. It's not going to be mass demolition. A lot of it will be refurbishment of and regeneration of communities that need it.
That's assurance I was asking for, because whether the Met Party talked about housing market renewal, from my point of view, it meant people in Anfield and Clinton being forced out of their homes into an extra debt, 10% investment for the county, which has been economically counterproductive. I know we have a different point of view, but I've got the right to express my view in dissent. And then just the last question, on democratic profiles, I understand what you're saying about taxation benefits changes the housing market demand and supply. One of the things I'm particularly concerned about is the age profile of the city and the fact one of the biggest needs I think I've got in my community, hopefully with the development of Methodist sites, we should counterbalance that, is the lack of sheltered accommodation schemes to help people downsize, which could then release more homes for family size housing. How do we see that being progressed? And is there any issues on improving the supply of sheltered accommodation?
I think you're looking at the supply of right across, and that it might not be just sheltered, it could be over 55s. I've met with Martin Farron from Madrid Social Care, and there's something, we need more accommodation for people with mental health, supportive accommodation for people with mental health. We need more foster. Large houses for foster. There's a bigger thing as opposed to sort of over 55 sheltered accommodation. So we are looking at right across the city what we need. So I can't
and who will be doing that and how that will be brought back to citizen information?
I think it will be brought back to the community. It's something that Davin's team is looking at, and I don't know that you've had it in terms of the work programme, but it is something that we're looking at in terms of the Barry and Children's Services. I've met with Barry. Barry's looked at foster carers and what is the need there. I've met with Martin and looked at the need of adult social care and what we need there for older residents, adapted residents, adult social care. It's a much broader thing. So we're looking at all the different things to bring it together, and maybe that'll come back to the committee.
Sam.
Large enough and on larger scale, he turns into HMOs.
So we are required as a statutory authority to provide a special plan with long-term vision for the city, which is through planning policies set out by national government, which we interpret by the NPPF, which is the National Planning Policy Framework, and we distill that into a local policy, which we deliver to the local plan. We've submitted that local plan to the planning inspectorate. The planning inspector is looking at that local plan currently and asking a number of questions in terms of the overall delivery of that local plan and the soundness of that local plan. In particular, he's raised some queries with regards to the housing design element, but we've brought this for you today so you can understand what we're proposing as a local authority in terms of housing design. So, firstly, we've got the executive summary and then just quick information of what's required in terms of seeking planning permission for development of residential nature, in terms of it needs to be compliant with the current statutory plan, which is currently the UDP, Unitary Development Plan. The local plan is expected to replace the Unitary Development Plan once the inspector is happy with its contents. We are expecting an examination of public later on this year. If we can answer the questions to his satisfaction, it may slip into next year, but certainly we expect to have an adopted local plan in 2020, of which then we can start deploying the relevant policies within that plan. So in terms of housing design, it's just set out briefly for you here. It deals with a mix of different housing types. So we're proposing family housing, self-built and custom-built homes, starter homes and homes for service personnel and their families, and we're also proposing that 10 or more dwellings, developments of 10 or more dwellings more, 20% of the homes to be provided must be affordable, comprising 80% social and 20% intermediate, so that's that shared equity housing provision. We also are proposing all the persons housing for that to help promote independent living. So the second part of the report talks about the design and the appearance. So we are wanting good quality housing design. And that's not just what the house looks like, but how it functions internally, externally, and together as a group. So if we have a development of 200, say, homes, it's how the place works as well in terms of good practice and good design. So in particular, CH13 talks about physical and design requirements. The inspector has a number of queries on this policy. So this is heavily caveated in terms of these are our proposals, so these may change as the examination of public progresses through the discussion of key topics. Housing almost certainly would be a key topic that the inspector would like to discuss. So there's other key local plan policies which also influence the design throughout the plan, which is in the urban design policy section. So that will override or umbrella the whole, every policy within the local plan in terms of achieving good design. So again, I've briefly touched on it. So there's physical, we're trying to achieve a design quality in terms of the space inside and outside of the home. With this, we're trying to suggest an accessible housing policy which tries to deliver those sustainable communities where if they are sustainable in terms of the mix of property types in any development that comes forward, and then achieving a relevant amount of space to support the outside living that's applicable to the housing as well. Environmental standards, that's a strategic policy, again, that's overriding throughout the local plan in terms that we want to provide sustainable growth principles for all development, which will be applicable to housing as well. And then we have a conclusion which again just touches upon the fact that this is our proposal to the government through the planning inspectorate. It's up to the planning inspector then to take on board our arguments, have those discussions at the inquiry, and then hopefully we'll come out with the next stage will be some proposed modifications if the inspector feels that policies need to be modified. One example of that is the policy that talks about the physical requirements of design. He said it may be too specific for that policy type, so one method of tackling those comments is that we could have supplementary planning policy in terms of residential design. So it's quite a complex issue, housing. It's one that engages a lot of the communities and obviously members that have to take some questions.
Thank you very much, Chair. Can I just ask on
encouraging home ownership, not just affordable housing. Because I think it is about providing a balanced community. It's actually important to have a balance of people who are owners. I absolutely don't wish to hide it any way, my absolute requirement, whereas shared ownership might be quite appropriate for the southeast of England, where people may not have capital to get on by housing threshold. When Liverpool has a relatively lower house price market, home ownership, shared ownership, I think is absolutely disastrous. That's protecting their rights and their capital investment. So I just put those 2 points to you. How does home ownership fit into sustainable communities? How can we promote that? And how would you answer reservation which should be encouraging home ownership, not shared ownership, where they have the least impact to control over their property with the greatest burden?
It's about providing a sustainable mix, as you said, but the policy is quite clear. It's only 20% of any 10 or more residential developments that are put forward to the council, and of that, only 20% should be shared equity housing. So it's quite a minimal amount, of which is coming out of the work and the evidence base that we've collected as part of the Cllr and Cllr, in terms of delivering the type of housing that we require as a city. So the majority of the housing that comes forward currently is private ownership housing for sale. So that this policy tries to secure at least 20% of anything over 10 or more to have 20% affordable.
And have you had any market research on those people who've been victims of shared ownership schemes?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
Because if I'm being truthful, if people have, I think we've got to really consider share ownership. Unless there's a change in their legal rights, which they don't have. They don't have the right to lease others, don't have the right to tenants. They're absolutely in a cleft stick. I would warn councillors as a friend of a neighbour, I would be horrified if I had large numbers of 20% share ownership schemes come into my ward without the protections they don't have as present.
Thank you.
Ross?
Yeah, I'm just looking at the policy. Where we are in terms of lifetime homes, and it's actually shocking the amount of properties that you go around the city, the number of new properties have got stairs up to the rear or the front door, which is clearly inaccessible for anybody. I believe it's everybody's right to be able to stay in their home as long as possible. And if we continue to build homes that aren't accessible, at some point everybody's going to need to be able to sometime in their lives. So we need properties that enable multiple disabled.
Yeah, I agree. Accessible housing is quite different to lifetime homes. Lifetime homes that doesn't exist anymore in its true form, and the local plan, what it tries to do is adopt the principles of lifetime homes through a policy that requires building control standards through Part 10, the building control, to Part 10 and 2. So we are requiring that at the minute we don't have a policy to insist on those standards, but the new local plan is proposing to meet those relevant parts. The building regulations Part 10, where once adopted, we can start. We're doing it proactively now, we're encouraging applicants at the minute, but at this current time we don't have that statutory framework, but the local plan will start to insist on that.
Just very briefly. I completely agree, but I am concerned if we don't put pressure on buildings, we won't do it, because it's not, economic. It's sooner just to throw something up than think about what we're doing, so it's not economically viable.
Sustainability and
authority yet. We are encouraging, we are working with developers to put as much pressure on as possible through negotiation. But once the local plan is adopted, we'll have a lot more statutory power in order to insist on these. So in terms of other authorities, I don't know exactly benchmarking, but there are some national standards that are set out nationally, which is the bare minimum. So most authorities, depending on where they are in terms of their adoption of policy, we're catching up in terms of that by updating the UDP. So hopefully once we have the local plan adopted, we'll be able to start implementing those standards with force, whereas now we're doing it through negotiation because we haven't got that statutory power to date. In terms of safety and sustainability as well, we encourage renewables, but once we have this policy, the statutory strategic policy adopted in the local plan, it'll be much stronger in terms of negotiating.
So obviously it's a slightly problematic screen in terms of resolution, but I'm just going to try and talk a little bit about general design quality, and it's across like a number of residential scale schemes, types of property, and I suppose types of aspiration as well. So my name is David Dixon, I'm a director of DK. the architects. We've been in Liverpool practice for about 30 years now. Got quite an expertise in residential development across lots and lots of scales, so from 21 story towers down to conversions of listed buildings, social housing of kind of all 10 years types and locations. Very fancy houses, and we go into houses that go beyond crazy in terms of the amount of money people have to spend on. So in addition to that, we do quite a lot of specialist housing as well. So the scheme on the left is an extra care supported older persons housing scheme in St Helens, which won a Happy Award, which is a national award a few years back. And we've got several of them included.